Merry Christmas, and welcome to this 10th episode of Talking South. Let me first walk you through the effects of loss of sea ice, so that you don't believe it's comparable to a rare type of butterfly disappearing from some remote swamp no one ever visits. When the ice finally goes, we lose the cooling effect that ice had on the Arctic Ocean itself. That starts an epic heating up of the Arctic, and the mountain ice sheet here in Greenland will immediately start melting much faster. The mountain ice will actually raise sea levels, and vast areas of the Arctic coastal zones will be flooded, releasing much more methane than today, from both permafrost and seafloor methane clathrates. Methane, of course, will heat things even further and catastrophically fast. The rest is the end of history. Why am I telling you this? Well, it's not to make activists stop fighting. It's not for this and certainly not for that. In fact, I don't even know myself why I'm telling you this, other than to follow the ideal of telling the truth. Do with it what you will. But back to the question at hand. Do we have a dozen years, or do we have minus 3 dozen years left to act in order to avoid these terrifying climate tipping points? Well, let's look at the term tipping point. In IPCC's 5th report, it's defined as a threshold for abrupt and irreversible change.
Now, the third section of the SPM, which deals with emissions and system transitions consistent with 1.5°C of global warming. Limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees implies reducing emissions of carbon dioxide by about 45% by 2030 compared to 2010 levels. For comparison, in most pathways that limit global warming to below 2°C, carbon dioxide emissions decline by about 20% by 2030. To limit global warming to 1.5°C, global emissions of carbon dioxide would need to reach net zero around 2050. This means that any remaining emissions would need to be balanced by removing carbon dioxide from the air. For comparison, pathways that limit global warming to 2°C reach net zero around 2075. As part of limiting warming to 1.5°C, reducing emissions of substances other than carbon dioxide that affect the climate would improve air quality and have direct and immediate health benefits.
Okay, thank you, Shukla.
Limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees implies reducing emissions of carbon dioxide by about 45% by 2030 compared to 2010 levels.
Limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees implies reducing emissions of carbon dioxide by about 45% by 2030 compared to 2010 levels.
So, returning to my question, do we have a dozen years, or do we have minus 3 dozen years left to act in order to avoid these terrifying climate tipping points? I realize it should be split in two. The former half would read, do we have a dozen years left to act in order to stay below 1.5°C in order to avoid these terrifying climate tipping points? I'll return to the short yes or no answer to that, but you probably already got a hunch what the answer will be. Now, the climate panel doesn't actually say we got 12 years left to act. Rather, they're saying something like, what if we cut planet exploding in carbon emissions by 45% by about 2040? This was the scientists handpicked by the politicians for their willingness to do science without too much negativity and or consequences for the economy. Then they handed over their work to the politicians of every country on earth, as well as their PR advisors, fossil fuel lobbyists, etc. Then these politicians wanted to sell the public a slightly different story, and so they ordered the scientists to redact their scientific background reports in order to better back up the agreed upon talking points of the politicians. So the summary for politicians by politicians said something like, what if we cut planet exploding carbon emissions by 45% by 2030 to 52? Then predictably, not least by the PR advisors of these governments, the press got wind of the press release and ran with their ginned up version of we got 12 years, says the UN. Of course, it's not 12 years before we all die or anything like that, but a shorthand for we got 12 years to act to avoid the Earth reaching 1.5C above pre-industrial temperatures. But I do want to make a note that it's totally arbitrary. It's got nothing to do with avoiding climate tipping points. There is no evidence 1.5C would be safe, and not simply a short stop on the way to 2C, 3C, etc. And there is no reason to believe we can cut emissions by 45% in 12 years. Remember as well that the scientists of the IPCC said about 2040, while the politicians wanted it changed to 2030 to 52, knowing full well that the press would run with 12 years. Why such recklessness? Well, it's no longer about science or about the data or about the hard limits, thresholds or tipping points. The good news is they care about you. The bad news is they only care about managing how you think about the future. Let me be clear. They want you to believe there's a positive number of years, not a negative number. With a positive number of years, they can still make a case they are acting responsibly. They can even claim they deserve our respect for having acted responsibly all along. Oh, what tangled webs we weave when first we practice to deceive. If you think fairly positive thoughts about the future, they get 12 more years. And any Scrooge McDuck will tell you that time is money. So 12 years is a lot of money. They don't care about when we actually crossed the climate tipping point. So, because I care about you, and because I care about when we actually crossed the climate tipping point, I will show you exactly when we actually crossed the climate tipping point, what a-ha song topped the Billboard Hot 100 chart that year, and how many tenths of a degree above pre-industrial the Earth was that year. Nah, honestly, I can't really do that due to the lack of data going that far back, but you get the gist of it. It's a long time ago, maybe even before punk. But let's try. So, a great poet once said, you have to step back from the painting in order to see it like the master wanted it. In the same way, we need to step back from the day-to-day changes of the Arctic if you want to see what is truly going on. Let's say the master, in this sense, is nature. When we zoom out to the 10-year average level for sea ice, we can really see what's going on. You are here. Oops. You are here. Apart from the little bump caused by Mount Pinatubo in the early 90s, this beast has been going down ever since the satellite era started. This is indicative of a system that's already crossed the tipping point and is now in abrupt and irreversible, almost freefall drop. It's like a ball that's been thrown and is following its natural ballistic path down to the ground. We notice the very first data point at the start of 1989, already starting a sharp decline. 1989 is the earliest data point in this plot because the data starts in 1979. But the 10-year average graph could also be drawn with centered values, you know, in the middle of the 10 years. That way you'd have January 1984 as the start of the abrupt and irreversible drop. That would indicate that the actual tipping point for sea ice was before 1984. Maybe 1983 or 1982, which would be exactly 36 years before today, 36 years ago. But we really don't know, because we have no sea ice volume data prior to 1979. For all we know, the tipping point may have been crossed before punk became a thing. So, the short yes or no answer to the question, do we have 12 years left to act in order to stay below 1.5C, in order to avoid these terrible climate tipping points, is no. We absolutely don't. The correct answer is closer to -3 years left. The longer answer is that in order to stay below 1.5C forever, we need to have not crossed the main climate tipping point already. Because remember, it's irreversible at this point, way after the actual tipping point. That means we can't go back, even if we wanted to. This thing is going to keep playing out until we have no more sea ice left, and then further until we have no mountain ice left. All because we obviously already crossed the tipping point. And from this plot, from the IPCC report itself, we can see what the real temperature limit was for triggering the tipping point of ice. It's either 0.5, 0.4, or 0.3 C. And yet today, the IPCC pretends that not even 1.5 C or 2 C is irreversible. They are such pathetic liars. I started by pointing out this was more important than the butterfly in the swamp. What I didn't quite say was how important it was. It's not that easy to put into words, even for a man of letters. I then suggested that the rest is the end of history. But that doesn't really cut it, does it? We know we've had prehistoric humans, and we know we'll have post-historic humans. So the tiny period we had history, meaning civilization, is coming to an end for sure. But so is the time of human populations of more than 1 billion. And so are the family lines of most current life forms on this planet. So we can all argue till the cows come home, or for 12 years if you want, about when the climate panel didn't know and was misinforming us, and when they did know and were lying through their teeth. But the fact is, the IPCC is in the pockets of the deep state. Don't believe me? Check the records. At one point, Exxon even sent a letter to the Bush administration, asking politely if the head of the IPCC couldn't be replaced by another guy. Someone more understanding of the needs of the fossil fuel industry. Did they get their way? Of course they did. So, it's not necessarily a story of everyone working for or with the IPCC having to know they are lying and covering up the collapse. As Exxon showed, they can all just be replaced one by one when a deep state feels like it. But that doesn't mean they're not guilty as sin. So, for a trigger alert, this is where the story ends on a hopeful note. Some people love it, others hate it, which only shows it is somewhat significant. But there is hope. Not in the traditional sense, of course, that we can somehow turn this ship around and avoid the collapse of global industrial civilization. It's a little too late for that. It triggered a literally explosive climate collapse, and so we all live in the age of consequences. In the age of collapse. Now, the only real hope, the good hope, lies in a near-future scenario of civilization collapsing before the biosphere, preferably significantly before the biosphere. We do know from science that the incredibly harsh conditions of snowball Earth likely spawned the evolution from only single-cell organisms around to the very basic concept of cooperation, known as multicellular life. That's how tough things were back then, and that is how drastic the solutions were. And ironically, we wouldn't have been where we are today, at the edge of collapse, if it wasn't for those stubborn single-cell critters figuring out a way to cooperate on a permanent basis. We also know that there will be post-historic human beings on this Earth. Hopefully, we will find a way to stop living up here and start living down here, to quote Eminem from 8 Mile.